Alright, so we get to show off the power of armed and armored, right? We could tap our ox in order to do that, but we're just going to take full advantage of the card, right? We're going to ramp 6 mana, and if we had our Ugin, we could lay an Ugin, just to point that out. Yo, hey guys, thanks for clicking the video, I really appreciate it. This is going to be Boros Vehicles. I'm sure you saw Colossal Plow on the thumbnail there, and yeah, that's what we're doing today. We're going to take a look at that card, which is right over here, and we added in some other sauce. We added in one more vehicle, which is the Carve, and of course, we end with a nice Ugin, the Spirit Dragon. So to get there, right, we need some pieces, because vehicles are kind of awkward in and of themselves, and you'll notice that we don't have many creatures. Now, why might that be? Well, that's because of one card called Armed and Armored, guys. So Armed and Armored is insane. It is instant speed, so you could actually use this defensively and make your vehicles creatures when they swing into you. But what this does is it makes our Colossal Plow, without having to tap anything, a swinging creature, assuming we laid it the turn before. And that gains us 3 life, 3 white mana, and is probably 6 damage to the face, unless they want to, you know, lose one of their creatures. Now, this has a relatively low toughness at 3, so we do lose it at some points. That's why we run 4, but we also have 3 of this card. So this card is 4-4, and you only have to crew it for 3, but again, we're not really worried about that because we're usually just stacking this on the field, right? And then we use a big armed and armory play to sort of get through and take advantage of this ability, which gets us a land. If not, it's at least sort of a pseudo scry. So kind of decent, and then those are our vehicles. Now there's one more card to look at in the vehicle category, and that is the ox. The ox is amazing. If you haven't seen this, you crew the vehicle using its toughness. So you can obviously crew the 6 costing Colossal Plow. So that's not bad at all, and you wouldn't believe how easy it is to do. 2 turns, right? You just lay this on 1 turn. The next turn, you ox. And that's a tremendous swing. It's usually ramping you into some of our other threats, which I'll get into now. You'll see right away that we have 4 of this card, right? Starnheim Unleash is insane. It's a mythic from Kaldheim. You can actually foretell this on turn 2, which, so that helps with our curve, being that we have a relatively interesting, right, you know, 2 slot, right? 2 drop slot. And we don't really want to lay this card early. We don't really want to lay this card early if we don't need to. So basically it helps fulfill the curve and give us something to do. Now we do run 2 Doomscars and then 1 Elspeth. Now that's kind of our removal package. Doomscar, obviously, you know, for going wide is going to take out stuff. Also has Foretell. And Elspeth can take out something very pesky like an Ashiok, a Planeswalker that's giving you trouble, or an enchantment like a Doom Foretold that will just basically wreck us. And then basically, you know, we have Goldspan up at the 5 drop slot, you know, 2 copies, not bad at all. We definitely like the treasure tokens that it leaves behind. That could definitely help us get us to 2 copies of Ugin. Now, everything in between, we have 2 Cosmos. This is insane. We gain a lot of life from this Cosmos Elixir. Against aggro, it's going to heal us back up. It's going to keep us alive until we can get down a bunch of angels, or until we can, you know, get down a few Colossal Plows and then hit them with an unexpected armed and armored. Now you wouldn't believe how powerful that can be. We can all of a sudden get up to an Ugin on as soon as turn 4. If we lay a Colossal Plow on turn 2, Colossal Plow on turn 3, and then we lay an armed and armored on turn 4, well, we're using 2 mana to cast this, right? And then 2 Colossal Plows are swinging, that makes 6. We had 2 left over, so 6 plus 2 is 8. So boom, that's amazing. Definitely very powerful, and that's what I think justifies it being meta, is that early Colossal Plow play into Ugin. Now, this is a mana sink, because as much as we love, you know, having mana, we don't really need all the mana in the world. If that does happen, every one more mana we get is a step closer to another angel. So very cool. Seize the Spoils, very good card. It does leave behind a treasure token, which is actually very good. And again, just kind of goes with Thrill of Possibility and helps justify the red early in the curve. Now Colossal Plow also makes, right, 3 mana, so there's another card that justifies that. Boom, bang, bam. Let's look at the lands, I would say. So Bonder's Enclave, right? This is an amazing land in this deck because every time we have a Colossal Plow swinging, that could be the 3 mana that we use. You know, that's a mana sink for 3. Oop, right there. We draw a card. We just have to have a Colossal Plow on the field, which we always will. And yeah, the rest of the mana is basically simple. We have one Castle Ardenvale, nothing too special there to help stall, you know, if there's some pesky green creatures with huge amounts of power and no trample, that can keep us alive. But yeah, everything's very, very good. You'll see today some insane plays with the plow. And thanks for being here. I really appreciate it. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the arena. Yo, alright guys, so this should be game number one of Boros Vehicles. So here it is, guys. Cool hands. Good enough, right? We have the plow. So this is definitely the card I want to show off today. Armed and armored, sorry. You can get some amazing plays off. So let's go ahead and just lead with a scry. Yeah, let's do that. And get rid of that. We don't really need two. It's a good card, but we do run three oxes and I believe three of this. Between those six cards, right, 1 out of 10 in the deck should be able to tap our Colossal Plow. Alright, so we're against rogues. This could be not so bueno. But we do gain a lot of life, so we're not worried about dying to like their creatures. Just really, really the mill. I don't know how to stop that other than just killing them before they can do it. We do have gold span. Alright. And a second Colossal we could get down here, right? As we lay our scry. Armed and armor next and get a big Starnheim, possibly. We would have to foretell that at some point, too. Okay. Depends on what we draw here. Okay, he's going to Mill City, USA. Ooh, an ox. Mill City, USA. Okay, so we can actually lay the ox here. Alright. We're going to end up laying the other plow. Okay, let's go ahead and swing, because this is 6 damage early, guys. Look at this, right? So, boom, bam. Okay. We can lay the other plow, and we should. Okay, lay this. Almost forgot to lay the land. Well, yeah, let's keep that, right? So we can get our gold span and whatnot. We need all the mana we can in the world, and Starnheim helps us to just always be a good mana sink for how much, you know, if we top deck mana and we don't really want it, at least our Starnheim is going to be bigger later, right? So, definitely why we kind of go with that route. They can also tap the vehicles that we make, so definitely an amazing card in and of itself, and works in the deck. Alright. Cool, guys. Oh, this is awesome. Alright, so we get to show off the power of Armed and Armored, right? We could tap our Ox in order to do that, but we're just going to take full advantage of the card, right? We're going to ramp 6 mana, and if we had our Ugin, we could lay an Ugin, just to point that out. And that was just such a good play that we pretty much had to go for it, you know what I mean? We can actually get our gold span down. Oop, main. Okay, yeah. You gotta click through all of that. And let's go ahead and foretell this. And now we are definitely good. Definitely good to go. So that was an insane play, right? We got tremendous damage and they had to block with their rogues. Ruin Crab. What you gonna do? What you gonna do with your Ruin Crab? Oh, that was a loud notification on my phone. Awesome, right in the mic. Wow, double. So we've gone through all 4 of these. Unless I'm crazy. We're at 35. I don't think we're in that much worry. Being that if we get one more mana, we can get 2 Flying Angels. That mixed with a gold span is nice. Obviously, we can just cast it with the mana we make from gold span. So that's what we're going to have to do since we got the scry mana. Ooh, another one. It's another one. And the cow can block all day. We don't mind if the cow dies, obviously. Alright, so we have to cast this for 2. Right, we have to pop the treasure, but unfortunately we can't take advantage of it. Yeah. Okay, definitely fine. X equals 2 is definitely like one of the primary you know, situations we'll cast that in. Ruin. Okay. Oh. Okay, wait, we didn't go through all 4. Oh yeah, we did. He brought him back. Sorry, I missed that. My brain fell asleep for about 10 seconds. Wait, did he hack? Does he have 20 Guild Thieves Enforcers in his deck? That, I've seen that cheat code going around, but he doesn't have flyers. So, like, what's going on? Let's block this. Alright. I think that's a GG. Yeah. Alright, cool. So, yeah, we just have a lot of flyers, a lot of evasiveness, gold span, the haste. Super relevant. And again, ramping and getting that treasure token. Definitely very helpful. So there's a lot of synergy within the cards. I'm glad we got to see it in that first one. Let's get into the next one. All right, guys. So there should be game number two here in Boros Vehicles. That number one was great. Go ahead and definitely check that one if you skip to the middle for any reason. But definitely a fun little set of cards we got to show off, right? The Colossal Plow, two plows swinging is just crazy. So anywho, a slower mana hand. Right, two scries. We don't really love that. I almost want to take out a scry and add maybe one more Crawling Barrens, actually. That could definitely be okay. We don't really need so much access to red. And we don't really need that cow, being we have no vehicles. So, we do have alternate win cons in this deck. We have two Cosmos Elixirs here. Those are the two in the deck. That can draw us an insane amount of cards, obviously. Let's do this. We can actually get... Yeah, let's get rid of one of the Cosmos. We don't need to have two. Definitely showing off how, right, amazing Thrill of Possibility is when you have high amounts of copies of cards. Especially when you have legendaries in your deck. You need to get rid of those legendaries sometimes. They, you know, you don't need three legendary creatures in your hand. So anyway, Thrill of Possibility is amazing for that. We can get down a Plow. And I think we just do that, even though it doesn't seem like a very progressive move. We don't necessarily need this land either. But we can get down a Cosmos. We are going to take a little bit of damage, but it is going to, you know, outright just heal us back to what it was. I assume he's just swinging with this one creature. Okay. Okie doke. We can get down... whatever. I don't know this. Okay, get down this Cosmo. Yes, we can get down the Solemn there. I don't think we need to immediately ramp. Also, I just think that two life every turn is insane. And we actually want to get above 20, obviously. I don't think it's going to happen. At least immediately here. Once we shatter, though. Okay. Not bad. Not bad at all. So, that's tempting. We can be greedy and just lay a Skyclave. No, let's just lay the Solemn. We're not in any pressure, you know what I mean? That's what I meant by being greedy. Because eventually we can hit our Ugin here and just be in an amazing position. Or anything else in the deck. But yeah, we're probably just gonna block this Blight Fang. We don't have to swing, right? We're drawing cards. We're gonna get our Starnheim unleashed. Definitely need to foretell that ASAP and get an amazing Starnheim off and just swing with all the angles. Okay, yeah, let's try it. The Myers Grasp is interesting. Okay. Okay, we're gonna lay this, right? We can use three here. And just have 5 mana for this Doomscar. We don't need to foretell this Doomscar. That'd be a waste of time. Yes, it's a very cost-efficient foretell, right? It goes down to 3. But there's just no point here, I don't think. I think we need to avoid any more damage and just start healing up above 20. Because once we get above 20, we start drawing cards. So, very good. Very good. Of course, Bonder's Enclave can be amazing once we draw into our creatures here. All of our creatures pretty much have power 4 or greater, being that we make angels and we have gold span. Okay. Let's lay this while we can. Let's just Crawling Barrens. Well, no, let's wait. We're just going to Crawling Barrens as much as we can. And hopefully he actually overcommits here and just lays, yeah. He's going to lay this, right? So... Apologize about my phone. and my coughing. Hope you guys doing okay. Thanks for being here. Okay, here it goes. Let's crawling barons. I don't think we can actually like block. Yeah, but we can do it twice. And we didn't even want to block, really, right? Because we're gonna shatter and crawling barons is gone. Now, an interesting playline is crawling barons can actually tap our plow. Oh no, that's sad. And we just do it because. Okay, so he took it out. That's fine. He actually took two life. He got rid of one of his last cards. Or actually his last card, yeah. This is just a really good shatter. Okay. Boom, bam, again, Cosmos keeping us in the game. We do gain a lot of life with the plow once we start swing. There's the ox. The ox can go ahead and obviously tap the plow. Now, I almost think immediately we just use this. This is a really good part of Bonder's Enclave here. Oh, awesome, another vehicle. So let's swing. That's a good amount of mana. See how easy it is to hit Ugin. We might have to put another copy of Ugin in the deck. Okay. End of combat. To main. Play this. Not bad. Not bad at all, guys. Dude, our opponent's name is sick, bro. If you haven't seen it yet, that's a lol. Okay, wow, he has a million of those. So that's good for him. Now, he obviously took out the plow. So, we tap the boat. Now, the boat, I guess I just didn't cover it here. We actually get to put a land card if it's on top of our library onto the battlefield. If not, we just get to look at the card. And it is power 4 or greater, so that's why Bonders is a 2 of in the deck. Not bad. Let's go ahead and swing. Yep, there's the land. Okay. We definitely didn't really want to see that there. At least we got it out of the way. He is going to block. No. He realizes that the Revenge of Ravens is really, really doing some work for him. Cosmos is definitely our best friend right now. Okay, Witch's Cottage. I see the strategy. And then he actually puts his own self, right, into the graveyard, which triggers his own ability. So, being that the legendary rule is kind of tailored to the way he was made, very interesting card. I like Sir Conrad. Okay, getting in for 5 is serious, because now we're at a range where it's like, yo, we need a solution now. This is not bad at all. Let's get rid of this scry mana, you know what I mean? We have all the mana in the world. We're not worried. Let's please get something. How about an Ugin? How about that Ugin, man? Now, he could have another Murderous Rider in his hand, which would be devastating. Ooh, and we got it, guys. We got everything we needed. Okay. Yeah, I mean, it was about time. It was long overdue. You know, we have 2 extra mana. I have a mana on hand. We're going to keep that in case we have to discard. Now, it's -4 what we have to do. Right? So, bing, 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 bonk. Sorry, bro. Oh, no, it's -5. Okay, okay, so not bad. I made a little bit of a whoopsies. Now, this could be okay, because whatever card in his hand he could use, try to hit Ugin, and it forces him to have to swing. Obviously, that was a mistake. Oh no, why is this a 5 drop? I'm a fool. Oh, look at that. Good for him. Good for him. Here's another Sir Comrade. So this is called Top Deck City USA. Now we have, what is 5, 7, 10, 12, 14. So X can be 6, from what I understand. Let's try it as 7 and watch it decline. All right. Yeah, so that declines. So 6 is going to work. I don't trust my math, so let's just make sure this way. Okay, so now what we have to do is tap one of these angels, swing with our vehicle. Okay, we're putting the pressure on. Obviously, if he gets another Gary, we could potentially be dead. But that is very, you know, he's top deck and he doesn't have a lock lane. We also just gained 2 life. So, guys, when you use the minus ability on Ugin, don't forget to count correctly. we're fine, though. Yeah, he wants me to block, but no, sorry. No blocks, because then we just win in the air. That would have been a huge mistake, right? We see what's in his hand. Got him, coach. So a little spice at the end, you know, just to keep it interesting. Thought you might appreciate that. Here he goes. Millen. Oh, one creature. Okay. Second creature. Alright. One more creature. And now, the moment of truth. He doesn't get it. Alright, guys. So, now what we do is we go ahead and swing. I thought I'd keep you on your toes, guys. So, definitely count with Ugin, and you could have seen how easier that would have been. But even though we made a crucial error, vehicles coming in, you know what it is. Let's get into one more, I think, and then that should probably be enough. Yo, what to do, guys? So this should be game number 3. Thanks for making it this far. I really do appreciate it. This is gonna be a pretty good hand, I would say. All right, cool. Leave with the scry. Let's see what's up. We don't really need that. No. Nope. If I could ever click, you know what I'm saying. Now we're against, what is this? Sarah Angel? Who is that? Someone's gonna hate me for saying that. Probably one of the older cards. I started playing Magic a couple years ago. Sort of when I started working in this restaurant. Let's get down the plow, obviously. I must have made a mistake. Get down your plow, then the ox. Ox can immediately tap it. Now what we do is leave up a red. Right, so we can seize the spoils. Probably an okay move. Yeah, so do this, right? Lay the ox. There we go. Let's do it. We're swinging in here. Now, I doubt he has any wipes, so we could actually just do this. Let's just get down our angel. That's not a bad play. That happens a lot. That was turn 3, though. So you saw we got a 6 damage swing in. We gained 3 life, and it gave us mana that laid an angel. So very insane playline. Let's go ahead and do this. Get rid of the scry mana. Because we get 2 cards and some ramp. See, these spoils is amazing. Not bad at all, guys. Now, if they counter it, since we discarded a card, that's a good play by them. But we had to go for it. There it is. Okay. We pretty much should have seen that coming. But, again, not so worried since we have so much damage on the field. Very strong against blue decks if we get ahead. But, again, interaction and removal is kind of our enemy. So, it's kind of one of those things. You can see there, yeah, they're starting to gain momentum. But if they can't immediately deal with this plow, you know what I mean? Okay. Let's just get down the mountain. And we'll continue to do what we're doing. Goldspan Dragon off the top would be lovely. Now, if they take out the Ox for some reason with creature removal, we have Armed and Armored. So, always have a backup instant, which is amazing. And they're definitely going to go for a nice counter on something, but we just have a big swing. They're going to have to deal with this. Okay. Go ahead and do it now. Okay, and he's gonna do the same thing. Okay, not bad. Didn't really see that coming. Relic Amulets. So yeah, whenever you cast an instant sorcery or wizard, you put a charge counter. So that's what's been happening there. Let's go ahead and do this. Not the worst thing in the world. Okay, we'll just do this. We are in an okay position. Of course, we can't have, you know, we don't have haste with our artifact creatures. With our vehicles, rather. I was thinking about adding one card, the 0/3 Defender that adds haste. Might do it. Just maybe a one of. Be nice. Tuck Tuck Rumble Fort or something like that, I think it is. Okay, go ahead and take that card. It does, you know, it does him nothing. So that's fine. And we're just really up to top decks here. We need to rely on Thrills possibilities to, you know, get us to cards that, that, you know, stay on the field. He had a good amount of interaction here. We're approaching 8 mana, so Ugin's a possibility if we need to just rely on getting an Ugin eventually. That's not bad. So again, we can't like Armed and Armored because it won't have haste. Was thinking of running Footfall, or what's it called? Foot Crater or something. Anyway, that would give it haste for just 1 mana. So just maybe a 1 of in there. Attach it to a land. Footfall Crater? Something? Who knows? Oh my goodness, that's the card that we want to use. Okay, he has a blocker. Lovely. Okay, we don't need more of those. That's unfortunate. Let's do it. Go ahead and swing. He has to block the plow. The plow will die. Okay. Oh, whoops. Clicking silly. Now something like a Inscription of Insight that returns two creatures to my hand would slow me down quite a bit, obviously, but we would get the land. Yeah, take that out. Give me a card. Do it. I'm not scared to draw a card. Yeah, I might even just throw a possibility on your turn. Why not? What are you going to do? Counter it? Aha! I came through. Beautiful. Look at that, guys. So, of course, this getting countered will be rough. We can't really have that happen. So, we have to wait. That's what we're doing. No point in swinging. These Relic Amulets keep getting a couple charges, and then, right, they do 2 damage. They're like little shocks. Not bad at all. He wants to just counter the big spell. But we got a way around that. Let's go ahead and do this. Let's just show him what we're doing. Let's say go. We'll pretend like we have a reason to keep up 4 mana. Right? They're like, what? Okay, maybe it's like a weird instant speed burn spell. But basically, they have to have a creature on the field. Because we're going to be, you know, at lethal. One more activation, which we can do right now. Not bad at all, guys. Okay, St. Hova. What you going to do for us, St. Hova? What you going to do? St. Hoves. Okay. I said yes for no reason. Okay, let's go ahead and do this. Does he have interaction? Looks like we're going in, guys. Good game. There it is. You can't stop the crawling barons unless you can remove it to my hand. Anyway, those were some good games. I think that's probably about it. I wanted to showcase the plow. We got to see that today. We got to see the carve as well. And let's get into the wrap-up. Alright guys, we made it to the end of the video. I really appreciate it. We got to see the Colossal Plow in action. There it is. We got to see how powerful Armed and Armored really is. And of course, Ugin, the Spirit Dragon, has always been wonderful. Goldspan, obviously the treasure tokens help us tremendously. Solemn helps us ramp. We got to see Cosmos be an MVP in one game. So that's very cool. And I think this is sort of the right way to play the vehicle deck. We do have a lot of mana sinks with Bonder's Enclave and Crawling Barons. Crawling Barons ended a few games. Well, it was a participant in all three games, so that's very cool. And yeah, Elspeth, just the one copy can help bring back an Ugin, right? Bring back a Goldspan, and Starnheim Unleashed was just an all-star. So anyway, that's my take on the vehicle deck. Don't be afraid to run four of this card. I think we might have needed to. Maybe take out one Ox and just rely on going super big at very, you know, very swingy plays. So anyway, appreciate it, guys. We'll see you in the next video. Don't forget to like it. And, all right.